you go to your local scrapyard and run across a battery bank that appears to be completely useless, don't write it off so fast. Sometimes you really can breathe new life into an old set of batteries. I have to admit that batteries are about as much an art as science, but the more science you have on your side, the better your chances for success. The three 24-volt battery banks that Tom got with his used system would appear to most people as a completely useless, lifeless heap of junk. Most of the batteries didn't register a voltage at all. They also wouldn't show a reading on the battery hydrometer. They were of no use at all. But today I'll show you the steps in getting those old batteries back into service. First, let's go over some things you need to consider when working with lead-acid batteries. They need to be in a well-ventilated, sheltered area. We borrowed a neighbor's garage and left the big door open. Wear old clothes. As the electrolyte in batteries begins to rejuvenate, your clothes will get lots of holes, so wear clothes that you'll throw away when you're finished. No sparks or flames. When you're reconditioning batteries, do not ever get an open flame or sparks near the batteries, or an explosion will likely result. You can look up HHO or Brown's gas generators right here on YouTube, and you can see some of the results of the same gas that are produced by reconditioning batteries. Protect your eyes. Wear goggles. You don't necessarily need them at the beginning if the batteries are completely dead, but as the batteries charge, the electrolyte is misted into the air by the gassing action of the batteries. Protect your skin. Wear gloves and long-sleeve shirts. As the electrolyte gases, the misting into the air can sting or burn your skin. Don't park vehicles too close. Anywhere that electrolyte mist gets onto car paint, it will turn it green. Stink. As you rejuvenate batteries, you'll notice a very strong, rotten egg smell. The fumes close to the batteries can irritate your nose and throat, so it's a good idea to just hold your breath when working directly over your batteries. Batteries get warm. The batteries will get quite warm to the touch when you're reconditioning, but this is normal and nothing to worry about. If they get hot, however, the lead in them can start to break down. So as long as it doesn't get over about 110 degrees Fahrenheit, it should be good. Loosen all the battery caps. This will allow the gases to escape without pressure building up in the cells. Second, let's set some ground rules when reconditioning and maintaining batteries. Don't add any chemicals to your batteries. I know there are a lot of anti-sulfation additives on the market, and I do believe in them, but only as a very last resort. Any other chemicals you add to your batteries is something I don't consider to be a good thing. Batteries should contain electrolyte and plates and nothing else. Don't add extra acid to your batteries. Sulfuric acid is already saturated with sulfur. If you add sulfuric acid to your dead batteries, then the sulfate on the plates has nowhere to go because you have added more sulfur into the electrolyte. Keep your electrolyte hungry for sulfur and more likely to pull the sulfate back off the plates by adding distilled water only. Before conditioning your batteries, make sure that the electrolyte level is right between the plates and the full mark. If you fill your batteries to the full mark, they might boil over, causing a huge mess. If the plates are exposed, you risk arcing and then likely an explosion. So fill it right between and you'll be doing right. Then just keep an eye on them. Clean the tops of your batteries before you start hooking them up if they're very dirty. Moist, dirty battery tops can put a load on the batteries, and that's something you don't want when you're reconditioning them. Don't use baking soda because that will neutralize the electrolyte and will most certainly render the battery useless. Just use water and an old rag that you can throw away when you're done. Clean all your battery posts and cable connectors using a wire brush. Get them all clean and bright. Don't put any grease on them until after you have finished completely installing them. Now that we've gotten all the pleasantries out of the way, let's get down to business. I use a process called equalization to rejuvenate batteries. It's a very slow but proven method of getting batteries back. This is done by overcharging the batteries with a high current and voltage. This literally gets the electrolyte to a state of gassing that looks like boiling, and it eventually turns into a milky white color because all of the gas bubbles in it. This helps scrub the sulfation off the plates and reabsorb the sulfur back into the electrolyte. The batteries get warm to the touch, and this is normal. Here we've gotten the batteries placed on a wooden platform on the garage floor. We have to use Tom's inverter to charge the batteries because not only does it have a charging feature, it can charge the batteries with much more amperage than, say, a car charger. But because these batteries are really, really dead, we're going to hook the best bank out of the three banks to get everything going. When we measured the voltage of the best battery bank, it measured out to only 4.7 volts. The next best bank measured only 2.7 volts. These readings are for batteries that should measure at least a nominal 24 volts. Since our best battery bank was only 4.7 volts, it wasn't enough to get the slightest grunt from the inverter. So this presented a new problem. We had to get the battery bank to at least 15 volts before the inverter would even turn on. We got around this problem by breaking the 24-volt battery bank into two 12-volt battery banks and then really using a car charger on each bank on its highest setting for 24 hours. Notice in this clip that our 12-volt bank immediately goes to 14.7 volts and the amperage is a meager 4 amps even though the batteries are dead and the charger is set to 50 amps. The reason for this is that the batteries aren't offering much of a resistance to the charger. The charger sees that the voltage climbs to its maximum point, so it pulls back the amperage to keep the voltage at the maximum charge voltage. This 14.7 volts on a 12-volt battery bank translates to 29.4 volts if this were a 24-volt set of batteries. The next day we did the same thing with the second half of that battery bank. Even though the car battery charger didn't really charge the batteries much, it gave them enough residual voltage that the inverter would start long enough for us to apply AC power to it. Once the inverter saw that the AC power was coming in, it switched into battery charging mode. I left the inverter at its default programming for 28.8 volts. I also had to program the inverter to use only 15 amps because we wired it to a standard AC plug and then plugged that into an outlet. The inverter is capable of using up to 30 amps AC, which translates to about 150 amps of charging power at the batteries. In this video clip, you can see that the voltage was 28.8 and the amperage from the AC was zero, so the batteries are still considered dead at this point. We let this configuration run for 24 hours. When we checked it at 12 hours, the voltage had fallen from 28.8 volts to 28.1 volts. Notice that this time, instead of the AC amps input being zero, now it's 10 amps, which translates to about 42 amps going into these batteries. This is a good sign. As the batteries start to come around, the voltage should fall quite a bit as they start to fight the charge. We let this continue through the night. The next day, we disconnected the inverter from the batteries to demonstrate a couple of things here. If you check the batteries with a battery hydrometer, all the cells show way off scale, as high as it can measure. Because the batteries have been under a heavy charge, the electrolyte readings are very inaccurate. Now that this first bank of batteries is starting to show some initial signs of life, we now wire all the remaining batteries into three 24-volt battery banks. I program the inverter to charge the batteries to 32 volts. This will get the electrolyte really active and get the sulfation on the plates absorbed back into the electrolyte. Note the sulfation in this cell. The sulfation you see is the white spots on top of the plates. This stuff is definitely all over the plates throughout the cell. We'll check this cell again later during the charging process to see what changes are observed in the sulfation. This time I've hooked up a DC amp meter so we can see exactly how much current is going into the batteries. We switch on the inverter and now we see 25.9 volts and 50 amps of charging current. Now all we can do is wait. It will probably take several days before we finally see the battery at the equalization voltage of 32. When batteries are really dead and you hook them up to the charger, the voltage will go way up. But as the battery starts to revive, the voltage will start to go down as the amperage increases. Eventually, the amperage will remain high, but the voltage will start to go up slowly. As the voltage gets higher and higher, the sulfation is absorbed back into the electrolyte. When the battery reaches the equalization point of 32 volts, the amperage will start to decrease until it measures just a few amps. That's when we can start testing the batteries to see what we really have. But for right now, it's just hurry up and wait. In review, here's how we get batteries rejuvenated and equalized. Charge the batteries near their maximum charging rate specified by the manufacturer. If you don't know the maximum charge rate, most true deep cycle batteries will be happy with 30 amps. We charged our bank at 50 amps, which translates to 25 amps per bank, even though they are rated at 50 amps per bank. Charge the batteries at 2.7 volts per cell. The nominal cell voltage for batteries is 2 volts. So if your battery bank is 12 volts, you have 6 cells. And 24 volts has 12 cells, and so on. This is what takes a long time. The more sulfated the batteries, the more time it will require. Once the batteries reach their equalizing voltage, let them remain at that level between 16 and 24 hours. This continues to scrub the plates of all the remaining sulfate. So after a few days have passed, we'll be back with more video to show the results. Have a great week. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to leave a comment and hit that subscribe button if you haven't done so already. Thank you.